Okay, so in the spirit of why you want to use the turning technologies in the first place, what I propose is that this is going to be a truly flipped session. And when I say it's a truly flipped session, there's going to be lots and lots of interactivity, and that interactivity will predominantly take the form of clicker type questions. But not always, because sometimes I'll do things on the hoof, and what I really want is total freedom from all of you. So hopefully you're now used to interacting during the course of today's session, and you're used to pressing your little clicker buttons, and you're going to get a lot of opportunities to do that, but I'd like you to feel free to interrupt me at any time. One of the principles that I believe in very firmly in teaching, and is something that is inbuilt into the whole concept of flipping and peer instruction, is that it's really important not to be too ambitious in the amount of material you cover in a set amount of time. I believe there's way too much material in most of the degree programs that we teach, and I want to be very realistic about what I can cover. Now, I'm also one of those people who gets an opportunity in my own small way to emulate Professor Mazur and to talk at various institutions about the wonders of flipping and, more importantly, the wonders of peer instruction, which to me is a reason to go to the lengths of screencasting your lecture to free up the time to flip. Why do all of these things? Do them so that you can do peer instruction. It's quite interesting, it's quite amusing, because the two examples that I've seen in the sessions that I've been sitting in during the course of today, one was Eric's. And in Eric's case, the peer instruction didn't work as such. Okay, he sort of glossed over it, didn't he? But it didn't work as such. It did not cause that transformative shift in the student's understanding that, of course, you're looking for on these occasions. And the other one was an example that was presented to us, a before and after peer instruction result, where, again, there wasn't that huge shift. Well, I have to tell you, as someone who's been doing peer instruction for a number of years in the field of chemistry predominantly, that peer instruction does work, and it's the closest thing to magic that you can do in the lecture theatre. It is quite extraordinary how effective it is, and, you know, do flipping, do it so that you can free up time to do peer instruction. But when you're doing peer instruction, and again, I think we've touched upon this in some of the sessions today, it's crucially important, and I expected Eric to say a little bit more about it, but it's crucially important the kind of question that you pose. The kind of question that you pose needs to be one, yes, that's going to split your group so that not everybody gets the right answer, but it's also got to be a concept-based question. It is a totally wasted opportunity to just get in the situation and ask a question, as Steve would have told us, that is at the bottom of Bloom's taxonomy. We need to pose questions that are more challenging. And so people ask, you know, is there a role for multiple choice questions in higher education? Well, 10 years ago, I would have said to you, no. Multiple choice questions are for quick marking of A-level papers. They have no place in higher education. But I've totally changed my mind. And what's changed my mind for me are two things. One, the realization it is possible to write a good multiple choice question. A good multiple choice question is not one that depends on what you can remember. A good multiple choice question is probing skills higher up Bloom's taxonomy. And the other thing is, we've got so much upon us in current higher education, much of it technology related, that really needs these kind of questions. It needs good multiple choice questions. So if you are doing peer instruction in your classroom, you need a very good multiple choice question. Professor Mazur touched upon the idea of a forced concept inventory. If you want to evaluate these innovative pedagogies that you are using in your classroom, you cannot just look at your examination papers. That is not a robust measure of learning gains. Robust learning gains need to be measured using instruments like the forced concept inventory. And those kind of questions were created on a very exhaustive process. They don't come lightly, they're incredibly valuable. So we need good questions in peer instruction, we need good questions to assess learning gains. Anyone here heard of a MOOC? Massive open online courses. These massive open online courses, they need automatic assessment. automatic assessment through good questions. Blended learning objects. Blended learning objects need very good questions. So for me, one of the secrets to good use of turning technology kit, good use of the peer instruction pedagogy, is the question. And so what I propose to do is to go on, hopefully, from Professor Mazur's session, to look a little bit more at this issue of the question. Because what we've noticed is that actually getting a good peer instruction question is quite difficult. Now let me stress, it's much easier in your own discipline area. Because of course, you're familiar with that discipline area, but more importantly, so are your students. And your students will, if they've invested in the process, as we're sure that we can make them, they will have done their homework, they will have had that preparation. So when Professor Mazur has to come up with a peer instruction question for a general audience like this, he's going to struggle, because we don't have physics as a background. I was a chemist, and the first time round, I got that question wrong. So it is quite difficult to do this, to find a very good peer instruction question. It's much easier in your own area, but what I want to focus on this session is how we can source peer instruction questions. That's really the gist of what I want to do. Okay, so just to summarise, flipping. Now, flipping is, for me, a concept, it's not a recipe. So Professor Mazur said it doesn't matter particularly much how you prepare students for your flip session. I'm very interested in this aspect at the moment, but the classic path that I, for example, use is I capture previous year's lectures and I give those as preparative materials to my students. That's the method that I'm using at the moment. And then the bit that we are focused on in this meeting is what do you do in your contact hour. So you've freed up all this time by getting the students to look at something in advance. What do you do during that contact hour? Well, just to summarise, if you want to make flipping work in your environment and you want to make the best use of your turning technologies, facilities and things, don't fall into any of the traps some of my colleagues have fallen into. Don't give them a 10-minute précis of your system in advance at the beginning of your session. If you're doing that, you're giving them a get out of jail free. You're telling them you don't really believe in this flipping process at all and that you're not going to force them to do the work in preparation. So make them do the work in preparation. Okay, now let's move on to what we do actually in those sessions. So what I do is I make them as interactive as possible. And so we heard a couple of references during the course of today to, you know, you've given everybody a clicker, so everybody's in the position of answering a question. I would suggest to you very strongly that it's crucially important that everybody does answer the questions. You do not want people to opt out of answering the question. Why not? Well, let me give you the extreme of what happens when you don't have turning technology kits. If you don't have turning technology kit, typically in a classic lecture, and lots of my colleagues do this, they ask a question of the audience. So they ask a question of the audience, and what happens is one or two people sitting at the front, maybe the second row, put their hands up and they answer. And it's always the same one or two people sitting at the front of the audience who puts their hands up. I refer to this group of people as teachers' pets. Okay? Teacher's pet is always going to answer the question. Now that might make the individual lecturer feel a little bit better about the interactivity that they're doing, but they're only interacting with a small group here. And you can pose as many good questions as you like in that fashion, but if you're doing that and only a small group of people are engaging with those questions, it's a waste of time. When I talk about interactivity, you want everybody in the room to interact. Why is this so important? Well, it's important that they feel their questions are addressed to them, because Professor Mazur alluded to this, you've got to emotionally invest in the question. You've got to feel that it's really important for you to answer the question. It's not just an emotional investment, it's a cognitive investment at all. There are essentially four steps in this process. One is answering the question. The second one we've seen is discussing the question with a peer who disagrees with you, setting up that cognitive dissonance. The third step is being polled again. Now you may think, oh well, you know, that's not so much important. It isn't just about finding out whether this process has worked, it's about embedding that new understanding and knowledge in the brain. And the fourth step, which might seem completely unnecessary if everybody's now getting it right, isn't unnecessary, the explanation from that sage on the stage of what is actually going on. All four of those steps are crucially important in this peer instruction model, and they're the things that we're trying to do in our session. Okay. So what is the objective of a question posed during a flipped session? What are we actually trying to achieve when we go to the trouble of composing a question? What are we trying to achieve when we do that? So what I've proposed, in the spirit of interactivity, is that this is a question. Now what I'm going to do now, okay, is obviously there are no responses on there. What I'm going to do is I'm going to break out of my PowerPoint presentation and illustrate one of the take-home messages that I have about this presentation. And that is that one of the things I want us to consider doing is sourcing the answers to questions, and I think Professor Mazur again alluded to this, sourcing the potential answers from questions from your audience. Okay? Whether that be, I think I wouldn't be insulted if someone referred to me as a student in this context. I think we're all students of learning how to use the Turning Technologies software more effectively. So in that sense, I'm seeing you as students, but of course you are learning technologists, you are academics, you have a number of roles within your own institutions. Right, so I can edit this. I've got clumsy typewriting when I'm under pressure, so you'll laugh at that. But what I'm proposing is that I source answers. So what are the most important objectives of a question posed during a flip session? Volunteer some answers, please. Yes. Okay, so can I put knowledge application, will that do? No, I'm forever doing it, it's a very awkward thing to do actually. Okay, right. I told you I couldn't type very well under pressure. Anybody who thinks that Professor Lancaster doesn't get nervous giving these things, he's got evidence that he does. Okay, yes, B.
Engagement.
Okay. Okay. Engagement, anything more specific? Because I'm happy with that.
Focus them on you and stop them being distracted by anything else they might be being distracted by.
My wife would kill me. Okay. Okay, and a C. Let's have a C.
Provide alternatives to the correct answer.
Okay. So the. Okay, that's interesting. I don't really set out necessarily to confuse people when I pose a question, but okay. We always have our distractors, don't we? Okay, so let's say that that is our question. And let's reset that selected slide. And then let's go back to presentation mode. Okay, so let's answer this question. Ignore K, if you would. I didn't think that was going to come back. So knowledge application, engagement on subject, or providing alternatives. What is the purpose of the question posed during a flip session? Right, now there is this phenomenon, and again, in the context of flipping, it's really important to know, why flip? Turning Technologies don't necessarily want us to flip. Why do we have to flip? Well, we have to flip because of this phenomenon, the fact that it costs time to do interactivity. We've heard from Professor Mazur how important interactivity is. So frankly, I put it this starkly, you have two choices if you want to have, if you want to actually teach something on a degree program. Either you cut out 50% of the content of your degree program and introduce half the time for interactivity, or you flip and you introduce the time for interactivity. But you've got to do one or the other. You must interact, otherwise it's totally pointless and it's a complete con in dragging people into the lecture theatre. Bless you. Okay, so we've got a few of you going for K. Those are the same people who think lectures are a good idea, aren't they? Okay, so we've got a few people going for K. We've got people going for knowledge application, engagement, and subject. I think these are valuable things that we want people to do. But what we really, you know, specifically, what we're not talking about what the purpose of a flip session is, but what we're really looking for is for the question to explore a concept, to explore the understanding of a concept. Okay, so knowledge application is whether you can actually use your understanding of the material, not whether you can remember something. So we're back to that issue again. The kind of question you pose, it's very easy to just bang, 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 knock out lots of turning point questions which are asking you, do you remember what the chemical symbol for gold is? Do you remember what the boiling point of water is? These are facts. They're things that you can look up on the internet instantaneously on your smartphone. They are valueless things. Concepts are what have value. Concepts are what 21st century higher education is about. And it's concepts that we should focus on when we're doing flip sessions. If you think facts are important, stick them in your pre-materials, but don't waste your time in the lecture theatre on them. Okay, so let's pose a question here. Who has done the most to advance the cause of education? Is it Michael Gove or Ed Mazur? Incidentally, these questions, these images were sourced from Creative Commons licensed sources, so I have permission to use this picture. Okay, so I'm going to hover over the button. If you haven't answered, you need to do it very quickly. So 90% of you are going for Eric Mazur, and 10% of you arrived a little bit late. Okay. So this is a pointless question, a stupid question that is wasting time. And it is in here to illustrate stupid questions that waste time. Because this is essentially a no-brainer. Everybody who's familiar with the genre of higher education will recognize that, thank God, Michael Gove never got his hands on it for a start, but that the contribution of Eric Mazur has been massive and is ongoing. Okay, so that's a poor question and a waste of time. So what alternative kind of questions do we have? Are there questions that require deeper thinking that would actually lend themselves to a peer instruction environment a little bit better? Well, we'll find out. So who is the most effective politician? Okay, so if we ask that one without conferring in the first instance, and see what happens. Yes, touchy subjects are best. Touchy subjects are perfect. You get a subject that people care something about, that's actually relevant to them. Don't ask them something, well, I think we all care about education, but don't ask them something that's not going to tax them. Okay, so we have 33 responses to this one. Now, this is where I would have loved to have asked Eric Mazur, because I personally always show my students the result of round one of peer instruction. I'm one of those people who does show my students the result of round one of peer instruction. Because quite frankly, peer instruction does work, and it is awesome to see the magic happening. It's awesome experience for the students to actually see the magic happening. Now, I'm not saying this is obviously a humanities type question, so it's not like the sciences, there won't be a definitive answer. But I thought that this question would get us into the sweet spot between 30 and 70 or 20 and 80, depending on your point of view. So we have a 38-62 split, which is not an awfully long way from the actual independence vote, is it? If you voted yes, now is your chance. Turn it around, okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to re-poll this question. Don't answer it until you've had a good chat with the person next to you. Okay. Now someone who won't be sensitive. Someone quite reasonably said to me, if you'd asked this question before Thursday, you would have got an even more. In fact, this question was different until Thursday. Before Thursday, it was a comparison between Alex Salmon, that firebrand orator, and Boris Johnson. But it was actually Gordon Brown's, appearance in the campaign that got me to change the question. But let's see whether we've discussed. So, answer again. See if the campaigners on either side of this heated debate have changed your mind. The hashtag 45%.
Not so much of a heated debate,
but
one
wonderful. Oh, have I? Right.
Okay, so we have closed the gap. We have closed the gap. We've closed the gap perilously close now. I want to say hashtag 47%. So we have closed the gap in this. And the point about this is really just the take home that I have for you is pose a question that is going to excite people's attention and divide them and be a reason for discussion. Don't waste your turning point technology in lots of banal, straightforward questions with obvious answers that are patronizing to anybody who's actually done a fraction of the preparation they were supposed to do. Because pretty quickly, people are gonna get bored of that. Because it isn't about the technology. It isn't about the novelty of the technology, it's about application of the pedagogy, and that comes back to us as academics. We need to pose challenging questions. So we need to pose challenging questions in, I don't know, did Professor Mercer, I don't know if he had a name for it, he called it a sweet spot perhaps, between 30 and 70%. I call it the Goldilocks zone, okay? So you can see why I would call it the Goldilocks zone, because it's not too easy, and it's not too hard. So it's in the Goldilocks zone, and that's where we want to source our questions. Now the question is, how do you get a question in the Goldilocks zone? It's a bit meta. So who is best placed to determine the Goldilocks zone? So here's our question, and again, I'll break open this slide. And what I'd like to do is to source potential answers to this question from you. Okay, so, yes?
Older students.
Yeah. Older students?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. And?
Goldilocks.
Okay, now what do we mean by Goldilocks? The student cohort. It is very fiddly. If you don't have a mouse, everybody knows what I'm talking about. It's very fiddly. Okay. So, we've got older students and we've got the current students. Who else?
Lecturing staff.
Lecturing staff. Okay, good. So, I'll put academics, shall I? Because I can probably spell that.
Postgraduate research students that teach, so
okay.
PGTs.
So you call them graduate tutors. That's one of those things. I think we can see that heading, but we don't want it to be behind the pen. But do we, anyone want any further options? I want everybody to feel invested in this process, so I'm very reluctant to turn down any further potential answers, but four will do for our purposes. Okay, so I'll reset this just in case someone answered the question before I did it. Imagining what the blanks would be for their own purposes, perhaps. Okay, so we now go back into full screen mode. There may well be more elegant ways of doing this with the free text, but I'm yet to figure them out independently for myself. So who is best placed to determine the Goldilocks zone? Let's have a question. Okay, so it does say best placed, which does imply there's a single correct answer to this question. Okay, I'm hovering over the button. So, 52% of you, so we've just got a majority there of saying Goldilocks. And yes, you know, this is, I think, what we would call a visual clue. So I prejudice this question in a sense. But actually, I happen to believe, as we've just illustrated in this example, that the audience, the student body, the people who have done the preparative work, who have read through the preparative work, who know where the issues in the preparative work are for them, are the right people to source both the questions and the answers. Now, if you use the just-in-time teaching approach, then in a sense you're used to doing this. The just-in-time approach is presenting the work and then having a free-form box where students can reply. And so you get that information, and in the just-in-time model, you use that information to inform what you do in the teaching session. But you could equally well use that information to inform what you do when you're posing your questions. And, as has been illustrated already, if you get a range of answers from your students, those answers will include the misconceptions that you're trying to hunt down and kill. They will give you a broad range of valid potential answers, and they're likely to give you a question that's going to deliver something in the Goldilocks zone or sweet spot for your peer instruction. So, when I was doing this, and this came to me yesterday, and I'm afraid, you know, I am subject to these whimsies, it came to me yesterday that Goldilocks, okay, Goldilocks is a fairy tale. So, what do everybody have in common? Very difficult in peer instruction. Clearly, we don't have the physics of thermal expansion in common, but I think we do have nursery rhymes, fairy tales in common a little bit. And when I put that suggestion on Twitter, somebody came back to me and said, oh yes, we do this all the time. In primary school, we ask students to put themselves in the position of Humpty Dumpty and ask Humpty Dumpty why he was sitting on the wall in the first place. So this is a question sourced from primary school students' answers. Okay? And I'm inviting you to do it. Make that what you will. But I'm inviting you to answer this question. Oh, this stuff's really quite deep. I think we could arguably have a good discussion about it afterwards, but we are running out of time. Humpty Dumpty was sat on the wall because he was... These are not my answers. These are answers given by primary school tutors, the students. Cajoled. I pronounce that cajoled. Is it spelled differently? Okay. Cajoled by peer pressure. We're familiar with this notion of peer pressure. Yes, okay. Admittedly, the primary school students probably didn't use that exact expression, but that was their meaning. Okay, so we have 39 responses. That's interesting. We now have more responses to this question, which is supposed to be on familiar ground, so I suppose it's working, on the nursery rhymes than we've had for any previous question so far. Where are these things coming from? Okay, so 58% of you. So if anybody asks, if you are like me, and actually, well, my kids are too old for Humpty Dumpty, but maybe I'll be a grandparent in a few years' time. And if my grandchildren ask me, why was Humpty Dumpty a fragile egg-like creature perched in this precarious position on the wall, then I'll be able to reply because he was trying to get a better view, okay? And I'll be able to do that with absolute confidence because a group of academics at the University of Manchester told me. Okay, so this is a bit deeper question. This is one that I'm almost proud of. Which of the three little pigs built the most environmentally sustainable house? Was it the first little pig, which I'm sure you all know, but was using straw as its medium? Or was it the second little pig with wood, or the third little pig that got hold of some bricks and presumably some mortar and all sorts of other things?
Nice.
Right, so we have 32 responses here. I'm amazed how quickly you answered that question, because I think it's basically. So we have a good split of opinions here. We have a majority of you going for the third little pig. But I think we have plenty of ammunition for those of you who are interested in the issues of sustainable environmental building, and let's face it, who isn't in this day and age, to discuss this one. So I'm going to turn this over as a peer instruction question. So I'm going to re-poll it here. So, get to it, I can't, you know, can't hear anything. Convince your peer why yours is the correct. So can I ask you in light of your conversations, and there's nothing I like about peer instruction more than the lecturer in the class next door, the lecture theatre next door, coming and finding out what the riot that's going on is. That gives me such a warm feeling. Okay? So there's a great satisfaction to do these. People say, well, how do you stop them? Actually, you know, people are not silly. They know it's got to come to the end. So if you raise your hand at the front of the lecture theatre, that does have the desired effect in my experience. Okay, so which one, let's answer the question again, please. Okay, so here there is arguably no one answer to this question, but it'll be interesting to see whether our discussion has shifted us at all. Well, I think the answer is it's shifted us very little. We no longer have an overall majority for BRICS. Oh, just to remind us, some of the issues here, sustainability means you have to look at the whole sort of life cycle of the building and decide what you're going to do afterwards. So one of the advantages over straw, which is actually a brilliant insulator, so you can resource straw, you make your building out of straw, it requires very little energy in order to do it. It's maybe not as robust as your wooden building, but there are, you know, there are arguments in favour of all three of these, and it's just the airing of these arguments that is the useful part of this process. An online platform, and it's an online platform that's entirely free. And what it allows you to do, or what it allows your students to do, is to compose multiple choice questions. So they compose multiple choice questions, and they have to then provide feedback on all of the different options they suggest as answers to their multiple choice feedback. Sorry, multiple choice answers. So they then present these things online, and then they may submit, say, 5 questions and have to answer 25, and everybody would do that in the group. And so what you do is you source a series of questions and feedback to those questions, and you get a large cohort of students taking those questions. And so what you can do very quickly is student source a whole series of very good multiple choice questions. If you give the students a little bit of instruction that you don't just want them recalling stuff, but very quickly they learn what constitutes a good multiple choice question. It can be an iterative process. They can learn from this. They can refine their multiple choice questions. And you can cherry pick the best of those multiple choice questions that really do divide the group and use them in your blended learning objects. Use them in your turning point questions. It's an excellent platform for doing these things, and I thoroughly recommend it as a means of sourcing these. So I've done a lot on the hoof, but you can do this in advance, and then you can bring them into the turning point arena. Okay, so this is my conclusions in a sense here. Be open to the student's suggestions. One of the principles of flipping is relinquishing a bit of control. So obviously, Professor Mazur relinquished control. He didn't know how that peer instruction was going to turn out. But even when it didn't work, it still illustrated the powerful pedagogical advantages of having a discussion. But the principle behind this is to relinquish control. You take this argument to its logical conclusion, you start doing more than just flipping the order of lectures and questions. You start to flip the roles. And the more that you engage your students in ownership of their own learning, the more effective that'll be. The old adage, which did occur this morning, that the most effective way to learn something is to teach it, is as true now as it ever would be. And this mechanism is one that allows you to get it. So use peer-wise, but don't be afraid. You know, if something occurs to you in the minute, as it did for Professor Mazur during his keynote, break open Turning Point. The flexibility of the software allows it. Break open. Compose a new question on the hoof. Students will appreciate that flexibility and that ability to do these things, and it makes it so much more personalised and so much more relevant when we do so. Okay, and a series of acknowledgements. And I am, you know, it's great today to actually be able to meet the great man in the flesh, shake his hand, and acknowledge in person the debt that those of us who are adopting peer instruction, I'd like to think that given 20 years, than I would have come to. You know, I was flipping quite naturally and things, but this key point of not being afraid to pose a challenging question, that's what it's about. Don't be afraid to pose a challenging question. Don't be afraid to pose a question that students will get wrong. They'll learn so much more out of the process. And I think we have Eric Reserve to thank for that. Okay, thank you.